So, we have here with us today, raise your hand and then I'll let you all introduce yourselves in more depth, but Don Swan with the National Park Service, Amy Markstein with the Bureau of Land Management, Brian Powell with Pima County, Carrie Ann Campbell with Sky Island Alliance, and Antonio Esquer with Protección de la Fauna Mexicana. Okay. And we asked these folks to just talk a little bit. We're just going to do it kind of interview style. And I've got some questions I want them to answer for all of you, but then we'll open it up to audience questions as well. And the idea here was to really ground us in what's already happening and the ways that we're already doing really innovative and adaptive work in this region related to climate change, but all the conservation stressors and pressures that we've been talking about over the last day, and to really get us on our toes for the afternoon session, we're going to be developing some more really implementable ideas going out of this workshop. So I will start by letting everyone introduce themselves in a little bit more depth and talk to us about some key conservation goals that they're working to achieve, a great stressor that's really affecting that goal, and then adaptive strategies they're pursuing to address them. So a quick little overview, and then we'll get into a little bit more in-depth questions around how these folks are responding to stressors and climate change in their work. So, Antonio.
Hi, I'm Antonio Esquer. I came from the Profauna, but in this case, not only Profauna, I'm trying to work together. I discussed this presentation with my colleagues from the Janos and Chihuahua grassland in order to figure out or compile what is the different goals in strategies. And our case is mostly several exercises of planning from a local, maybe for a ranch or for a preserve or a state, or even in ecoregional exercises, have the similar conservation target, similar stressors, and similar strategies. So we compile in the beginning, we start with more green activities, but now we are passing or adapting to be more involved with community.
Hi, I'm Carrie Ann with Sky Island Alliance, and so many of our partners in the room, but if you're not familiar with Sky Island Alliance, we are based in Tucson, Arizona. We're a binational conservation organization working to protect and restore biodiversity of the Sky Island region. We work across the U.S.-Mexico border and across jurisdictional boundaries with federal and state agencies, private landowners, scientists, students, and volunteers to link large-scale conservation planning and policy to on-the-ground restoration actions. My job is the latter part of that, getting into the nitty-gritty on-the-ground work. We work hard to connect people and communities to natural resources through citizen science and volunteer activities, and so I think that's one of the special things that Sky Island Alliance brings to the region. I took the liberty of hopefully being able to discuss two conservation goals. One is increasing ecosystem resilience to large-scale wildfires. The stressors we're responding to there include increasing size and intensity of wildfire as climate changes. The specific strategy that we've been using to address that is the installation of hundreds of loose rock erosion control structures in pre- and post-fire watersheds. This is not something we've done on our own. We've had to coordinate and collaborate very closely with the Coronado National Forest and other conservation partners like Cuenco Los Ojos and Borderlands Restoration. Local students from Douglas High School as well got into the action, and Department of Corrections as well. This is not new technology, but something that's been done for thousands of years and achieves normal watershed restoration objectives like keeping soil and water in the watershed and repairing downcutting of streams. However, we wanted to look at it from another perspective as well. Can we create localized area of higher soil moisture, which may create pockets of lower intensity burning, and also islands of native plant regeneration after fires? Another large conservation goal we've been working on and really are hoping to expand in the next year is easing transition for a variety of different pollinator species across the landscape. Some of the stressors that we're responding to there are accelerated changes in winter precipitation patterns, increasing temperatures, and earlier onset of spring. We have lots and lots of strategies there, so I should probably truncate. Yes. Okay, we'll come back to it. But concentrating native plantings in specifically chosen areas with species palettes that are carefully chosen to be not only appropriate under current climate realities, but into the future as well. And I have lots and lots of specific things related to that that we might get into if you're interested. Those are my two things.
Hello, my name is Amy Markstein, and I work for the Bureau of Land Management here in the Tucson area. And the BLM, while it is the mission of the BLM is multiple use and sustained yield, the BLM also has the National Landscape Conservation System. And here in this area, in the Madrean region, we have the San Pedro Riparian National Conservation Area and the Las Cienegas National Conservation Area. And both of those areas are congressionally designated conservation areas, and they each have a public law from which our goals stem from. So in Las Cienegas, where I'm going to focus my discussion, our goal is to maintain an intact and functioning grassland and riparian ecosystem. And some of our big stressors in for both of these areas is just a really uncertain climatic future and drought. Those are two big stressors. So for Las Cienegas, our approach to identifying adaptation strategies has been to do the first phase of a scenario planning process. And I'll talk more about what's come out of those, out of that scenario planning process in the following questions.
Hi, my name is Don Swan, and I work at Saguaro National Park. So on the map, Brian's map behind us, Saguaro is two districts on either side of Tucson, like bookends. So in the on the west side over by the Desert Museum and on the east side in the Rincon Mountains. We're both Sonoran Desert and Sky Island. The east district is about 100 square miles and goes up to almost 9,000 feet in elevation, so has mixed conifer forest at the top. In the National Park Service, our key goals are to protect natural resources and other resources that parks are established for future generations, while at the same time allowing people the opportunity to enjoy those resources. So at Saguaro, that translates into protecting species like the saguaro that the park was created to protect, communities like the Sonoran Desert Plant Community, like the wildlife community, and then ecosystem integrity. So just, you know, kind of connecting the forest to the streams, to the desert. I'd say three of the stressors that we're most concerned about, we have many stressors being on the edge of a city of almost a million people. Three in particular that I think are important are invasive grasses, particularly buffel grass, which not only directly competes with Sonoran Desert plants, but also carries fire. And most Sonoran Desert plants aren't adapted to fire. Water, so just the impacts of climate change and urban development on our water sources, our intermittent streams, our springs, our tinajas, which are often spring-fed stream pools. And then just connectivity for wildlife. How can we maintain our wildlife communities as the parks become surrounded, increasingly surrounded in a sea of development? So those are some of the major stressors. Strategies. So I think I'll talk about strategies later.
That wasn't fair for me to put them on. notice there. Brian Powell with Pima County. We're an organization of about 7,000 employees. We have an annual budget of about $1.3 billion. And the conservation group within the county represents probably about 25 to 30 employees spread across three departments. For the last 17 or so years, we've marched under the banner of the Sonoran Desert Conservation Plan, which has a goal to maintain the full complement of native species to Pima County and the ecosystem structure and function upon which they depend. That is no small task. There's no timeline to that. That is the goal that we have. Some of our major stressors, in addition to what's already been mentioned, are the issues outside of our jurisdiction and our capability to have an influence on, for example, mining and groundwater pumping. For our conservation strategies, I put up a map here. I'm the only one that got a slide. I feel really lucky about that. But you can see the areas in green are county conservation lands. Most of those lands have been purchased since 2004. We went before the voters of Pima County and we asked them to support conservation. And they said yes to the tune of about $175 million in bonds, which we are rapidly paying off. Unfortunately, we had a bond measure last November that failed. However, we were able to purchase and lease the lands that are shown in green. They're all over eastern Pima County. They represent about 200,000 acres. So now we've gone from sort of a planning group to a major land management organization with a lot of edge. But you can see in that map that a lot of our lands are actually butt up against existing lands like Coronado National Forest, Saguaro National Park, and other Las Cienegas and so forth. So we really see our conservation efforts as sort of complementing existing land management agencies. We also have a regulatory authority, and this is another part of the Sonoran Desert Conservation Plan that's really kind of powerful, and it's a tool that a lot of other jurisdictions that are trying to do good conservation work look to us as an example, because we incorporate biological information into our land use decision process. For example, in the rezoning, and particularly in the rezoning process, where we try to leave land set aside for conservation in large developments for the movement of wildlife and so forth. So I'll talk a little bit more about that. And the last thing I'll say is, in terms of the last sort of iteration of our comprehensive planning process, was sort of incorporating some new ideas about health and economy into our conservation planning efforts. So I'll talk more about that maybe a bit.
Okay, thank you. So I think we heard, raise your hand, whoever it's gonna wanna answer first. But I think we're hearing a lot of themes here that really resonate with what we talked about yesterday with the stressors that we're dealing with around invasive species, water, connectivity for wildlife. And again, a lot of themes here around people working far outside their jurisdictional boundaries, or for some organizations, maybe working where they're not even the manager of the land. So, so in thinking about what we've been talking about the last day, we've got some pretty big challenges in front of us in this region, and we're trying to think about how we can really address some of these over the coming years. So could folks on the panel speak a little bit about any new approaches you're taking in response to climate change, sort of where you're going with your work in terms of addressing some of these stressors that you really maybe can't deal with on your own, in your own agency, and just give us an idea about that sort of where your work's going and those changes.
I have the microphone. I'm not gonna give it up. So. two things. One is we haven't necessarily incorporated climate change specifically into the work that we're doing in a really kind of broad scale and from a policy perspective. We actually don't have really a policy from the Board of Supervisors directly related to climate change. However, one thing is that the floods and the El Nino floods of the 1980s actually really were the first kind of clarion call to understand the effects of like big scale flooding. And that actually created at the state level a regulatory authority on the parts of the counties to have flood control districts. And the work that the flood control district now does is really important in terms of buying up land for conservation and allowing natural processes to happen. So I think that was really kind of important. Not maybe that was a climate change signal, I'm not sure. But the other thing is, I think the recent drought of the last 15 to 18 years has also sort of woken a lot of us up to, you know, the climate future that we are all facing. And it allows us, I think, in a lot of the conversations we're having here at this meeting and previous meetings, is really focused, laser focused us on water resources and the importance of water. And then I'll just also mention the collaboration effort. One thing that we've actually done here at the local level and working with Don Swan and some others is creating this thing called, we call the, this is just one example, but the Lowland Leopard Frog Working Group. Focused around the Santa Catalinas and the Rincon Mountain Complex, recognizing leopard frogs as kind of this important species we need to be looking out for, and that we look into the future and the climate change future. That's a species that will become increasingly under threat. So I think kind of from big scale events to kind of smaller scale planning, we are incorporating climate change ideas and processes planning in our planning.
So in the Park Service, climate change is challenging, I think, in the sense that if you kind of look at our mission, it's really to protect the resources when the parks were established with the idea somehow of a kind of stasis. And so obviously with climate change, we're not looking at stasis. And so as an agency, generally, we don't do a lot of manipulation and direct management. We're not likely to move saguaros to the Grand Canyon. So what we do is try to, kind of help the environment be more resilient by managing impacts to natural processes. So we do a lot of invasive plant management with buffelgrass. We use manual pulling and herbicide. We're experimenting this year with aerial treatments in areas that are extremely difficult to get to. And we've had some pretty good success in that. So, part of what we're trying to do is manage this plant. We know that we can't eliminate it from the park, but we can create some hope that this plant that has the potential to do so much damage to the Sonoran Desert can be managed in a way that's successful. I think in terms of water management, a lot of our adaptive strategy is really kind of about awareness that things are changing, the need for much better science, working with the Sky and Alliance, working with the Springs Institute to try to better understand our high elevation springs, which appear to be losing water that may be related to climate change or it might be just related to the way we manage them today compared to the past. We're finding that some of our waters are connected to aquifers outside the park, and so really, the main adaptation strategy is kind of what we're doing today, which is working with other groups beyond the boundaries of the park, recognizing that water doesn't know boundaries, wildlife doesn't know boundaries, and so how can we work together on that? So very similarly with wildlife is gaining information, sharing information, and then really sort of looking across the landscape. Something we talked a lot about yesterday was just sort of, not necessarily corridors, but really thinking about landscape permeability, which is something my boss Scott Stoneham talks about. How can we soften the landscape? How can we make the potential for animals to move in and out of our protected areas more easily? We are very concerned about the potential loss of species from our park as they become islands in development. So I think kind of working together, looking at linear infrastructure, looking at changes to the way that we manage the landscape is an important part of what we're trying to do and why we're here and why we're excited about this process.
So for BLM, we have, as most of you in this room know, we have a long history of collaboration and collaborative adaptive management on the Las Cienegas National Conservation Area. And the plan that was developed for the Los Cienegas National Conservation Area was completed in 2003, right as climate change was becoming an issue. And the collaborative adaptive management approach has worked pretty well with the assumption that things will stay the same, that there won't be that climatic uncertainty. But as we've moved into more of a uncertain climatic future, we have tried to shift to using more of a scenario planning approach in determining how we implement that resource management plan. So we, in 2010, 11, 12, did the first phase of a scenario planning process. And even though we only did the first phase of the scenario planning process, it really illuminated some very interesting adaptation strategies, some of which we have started to implement. And really what it helped BLM with was what we were prioritizing in how we were implementing our resource management plan. So one of the big takeaways from that was, instead of focusing on doing vegetation treatments across the entire landscape, that process helped us refocus on improving erosion and some more light on the land approaches to improve erosion. And also, these are sort of low risk techniques that can get you a big buy-off. So that was very helpful in how we're implementing that resource management plan. And then the other thing that came out of that was very, very interesting was really refocusing on engaging the youth in caring about these places and understanding some of these big challenges. And one of the scenario was that no one cared about these open spaces. And that has helped us really prioritize and do this youth engaged stewardship program out on Los Cienegas every single summer.
So one of the best tools that has emerged for us over the past couple of years has been the Sky Island Restoration Cooperative, which is a loose gathering, convening of lots of different restoration partners throughout the region, including federal and state agencies, private landowners, other conservation organizations, where we get together and share information just real literally about what are we doing, where are we doing it, and how can we find ways to weave our projects together for better bang for the buck, more conservation outcomes that are better. And it's been really effective and has really benefited Sky Island Alliance's projects a lot in terms of, getting us more integrated throughout, for instance, the rock work that I mentioned in just a few minutes ago. Through the CERC, we were able to identify that, USGS is doing lots of work to try to characterize vegetation response to these kinds of structures. How can we work together to get into their research program and then be able to better discuss the results from the work that we're doing? So that is one thing that's been very, very beneficial to us. And then in pure Carrie-Anne form, I got really down into the nitty-gritty when I was thinking about answering this question and, very specific changes to approaches that we've been making in response to climate change. And for restoration and plant materials, one thing that I've been very sensitive to is that, we always work with natural precipitation patterns when we're doing planting projects. That has always meant planting in the early spring, planting with the monsoon, trying to ensure that as many plants as possible that you put in the ground have as good a chance as possible of surviving. However, spring is coming sooner, warming up quicker, and I've really been taking that into account in my project scheduling in terms of really focusing planting activities with the more reliable monsoon and fall moisture patterns. So that's one really tangible way in which we've changed our workflow. And another thing I was thinking about in answering this question was, you know, Sky Island Alliance has been known for many, many years as, you know, really engaging volunteers and citizen scientists, and that's something that we still do very well. However, the reality of some of this work is that it may not be appropriate for volunteers, and so really trying to think bigger about other ways to get work accomplished, whether that be through paid crews or youth interns, things of that nature.
Okay. No, desde pedimos que los principales amenazas o estresores tienen que ver mucho con el cambio de uso de suelo, agricultura y también por el sobrepastoreo. Y entendiendo que la mayoría del desierto chihuahuense pues le pertenece a rancheros y son los que realmente manejan el paisaje. Y entendiendo también que un pastizal en buena condición, en grandes superficies, pues es la mejor manera de adaptarse al cambio. Muchas de las estrategias que hemos estado moviendo todas las organizaciones de conservación que originalmente...
Okay. So I'm going to talk about the major stressors in the Chihuahua landscape. The first one is the land use that we have is a great stressor because there's aggressive ranching all over, and the ranchers are really the ones managing the landscape. And we all know that the best way to adapt to climate change is a healthy, wide grassland, which we don't have.
Okay. Y digo, al principio, todas las organizaciones que trabajamos en esa región, pues empezamos por uno que estableciendo reservas privadas, haciendo acuerdos de reservas con rancheros, estableciendo reservas de la biosfera, etcétera. Pero al final del día eso no es suficiente. O sea, y ahorita hay un movimiento bastante fuerte para promover mejores prácticas ganaderas que conserven el suelo, que ayuden a mantener una buena cobertura vegetal y hay cada vez más rancheros interesados en esto o al menos interesados en la discusión de cómo tener manejos que sean sustentables en términos del ambiente pero que también generen beneficios económicos. Y también las organizaciones estamos buscando formas de incentivo, estamos tratando de replicar modelos que se hacen en otras regiones de México donde hay incentivos económicos para aquellos ganaderos que mantengan buenas condiciones y también estamos buscando mejorar la captura de carbono para que esto también tratar de, es todavía un
They're not going to understand. So, the strategies that we're using as a whole, the whole group is the organizations that are working in Chihuahua was at the beginning to ask for the reserve and create a private partnership with the ranchers for them to reserve a part of their land. But that was not enough and it didn't work as well. So now we're moving towards better practices. For the soil quality and to increase the cover. And we are also talking to them about making it sustainable, how it's important for them to improve their better rancher practices. And the third thing that we're doing is that we're finding ways to put money into it, to include better practices that have been going on throughout Mexico, where ranchers are rewarded for their better practices and their carbon capture.
Y en este proceso, pues obviamente también tenemos que entender hacia dónde va o hacia dónde nos empuja el cambio climático. Se han hecho algunos estudios hacia dónde se van a mover las especies, cómo se va a afectar el patrón de lluvias, etcétera. Y esa es algo, esta información que también tenemos que pasar a, a los dueños del paisaje y para tomar estas decisiones también. Se están haciendo obras de restauración. Anteriormente se utilizaban ciertas prácticas de conservación de suelo y agua que eran no necesariamente efectivas y últimamente se están utilizando otras técnicas como esto que le llaman key lines, que parece que mejora o direcciona mejor los flujos de agua y la restauración, el uso de gaviones y otras técnicas. Y finalmente lo que realmente para cerrar, los flujos de agua. Y finalmente, pues siempre tratamos de ir incorporando ranchero por ranchero y demás, pero ya a escalar del nivel de rancho, hacer que estas prácticas un poco más a una escala mayor, ¿no? Incluso tratar de buscar a nivel de las asociaciones ganaderas y demás.
We are very worried about climate change, and we know we have models where we know how the species are going to be changing their routes and their habitats, and also some models that talk about water and precipitation. So we need to get that information to the ranchers who really own the landscape in Mexico. We had been doing a series of restoration practices that have not been the most efficient, so we're changing that as well, like using key lines and restore the water pipes. And we are trying to get more ranchers involved in this, but we are thinking that the best way to do this is escalate it to become widespread and use the ranchers associations as umbrella organizations that might lead us to touch base with more people.
Yo, al final, lo que queremos también es que al tener un mejor paisaje, un mejor hábitat, obviamente todos aquellos proyectos de conservación fundamental que tienen que ver con especies prioritarias, pues sean, se den en un escenario mejor, ¿no? O sea, toda la recuperación de esas especies prioritarias y los procesos ecológicos.
At the end, we are aimed at improving the habitat as a whole, with constant better practices, and to protect and increase the number of endemic species throughout the region that we manage. Thank you.
So I think out of all that, I'm hearing this theme that came up a little bit yesterday for sure in discussing stressors and how we might respond and thinking through prioritizing those, that some things we're really going to be able to address directly with management, and some of this is about changing our approaches and thinking at a bigger scale, focusing in on things like water resources as a really high priority, keeping this really strong awareness that things are changing and tracking that and trying to get a sense of how that's affecting our conservation goals, and really working more effectively together, again, at these larger scales. I'm hearing those themes. And I think, you know, folks brought up some sticky issues that really changed their perspective on their approaches, like the youth, you know, thinking out into the future, and if youth don't grow up caring about having open space, where are we with conservation? You know, I think there's some big, looking at all that we produced yesterday morning on the screen this morning, those sort of big, meaty goals that we all want for this region, I think, you know, there's some tough questions for us about what we focus on and how we prioritize. And so I'd like to ask the panel if you have any thoughts or examples to share around having to change your actual management goals or modify what you're trying to achieve in light of these stressors and climate change and the current situation.
Yo creo que es lo mismo. Hace varios años, 5 o 10 años, la visión era crear reservas y el monitoreo y demás. Pero una situación creo que es particular de México, que el establecer una reserva no garantiza que haya aplicación de la ley para ciertas cosas. Entonces, y sobre todo en temas de sobrepastoreo, lo que hemos cambiado en vez de imponer es más bien tratar de que haya unos cambios o que se adopte voluntariamente mejores prácticas que que sean mejores para los terrenos y para la economía, ¿no? O sea, creo que ese es el cambio más importante que hemos hecho en la manera de trabajar todas las organizaciones, que originalmente teníamos un perfil más verde y ahora somos un perfil un poco más sustentable, ¿no?
So well, I think that the main key part that has changed in the last 5 to 10 years is that before our focus was to create reserves and monitor, and that was it. But in Mexico, creating a reserve does not guarantee that the upholding of the law. And so we still had problems with cattle ranching, and we moved away from that to focus on better practices with the ranchers, not so much a change in the law, and we can have more direct change there. So the organizations have changed our profile from going environmental to going into socially responsible, because we see that as a key part of our job now.
One of the things that always comes up in almost every restoration project that we have is how to deal with invasive species, either before the project or as the project is implemented. And certainly over the past few years, I've had to adjust my expectations about what is feasible and worth spending effort on in regard to invasive species. We've really moved away from goals of necessarily always thinking about complete eradication and moving toward protecting islands of resources for wildlife and pollinators within a matrix that probably includes a good number of invasive species. Another key point there that I've been thinking about is increasing tolerance for specific invasive plant species that may actually be providing floral resources for pollinators at critical times when there aren't native species providing those resources. And so this has been a very, very big shift for me. I was the past president of the Arizona Native Plant Society Tucson chapter, so this is like big steps. Certainly something that in terms of, you know, really weighing the cost benefit when you're working on a site, choosing your battles, and you know, I'll never think that it's okay to just let the buffalo grass and the fountain grass go wild, so don't worry about that. But some of these other species I've had to soften on.
So changing management goals and objectives is a little bit difficult for BLM, since those goals and objectives at the land use planning level, those are land use planning decisions, and they are what drive BLM's management on BLM lands, which is a good thing. On the flip side of the coin, however, when you do have these unexpected changes, it can be difficult, since you have spent 5 years or so coming up with these objectives, which then may not be realistic in light of new changes. So one of the strategies that we've talked about on Las Cienegas specifically is using this concept of nested objectives at more of the implementation level, where it's a little bit easier to change those management goals and objectives, and really focusing on the core components of what you need to keep that ecosystem functioning. So an example of that would be really just focusing on ground cover as the core of your nested objectives.
So, so one of the things that comes to mind for me is that, you know, we're focused on the environment changing, but we also, of course, all know that the entire world is changing. So the way that humans communicate is changing. The way that we get information to each other is changing. Everything is changing incredibly rapidly. And so I think part of what we are trying to do, and we need to do more of, is sort of create a different kind of awareness about our relationship with the environment. So part of that for the Park Service is an acknowledgement of culture, a recognition that people have always been part of these natural places, that you can't separate natural and cultural resources. And also an awareness that people are still very connected to these places. So when a drop of rain falls in the Rincon Mountains, you know, that's going to make its way down through the aquifer and be the water that we use to brush our teeth with or drink. And so kind of, you know, we can use social media. We can reach out to young people in ways that we haven't tried to do in the past. We use social media. Like this year for spring equinox, we celebrated the springs in the park. And I think there's so much more that we can do to sort of create to use these tools, technology, to create a larger awareness. I think the second thing is a lot of what we've been talking about this morning and today, which is using new technology to share data in ways that we haven't been able to do so easily as in the past. So with wildlife cameras, for example, there's a great need for information on the distribution of species, particularly mammals. There are many, many different organizations that are using wildlife cameras to take photographs of mammals. We're not really sharing that information. We could make much better management decisions about mammals if we could share that data more effectively. So part of what we're very interested in doing is engaging with our partners to share those data, to use new technology to make it easier to do that, and then to really translate that down to on-the-ground kind of management decisions about how we can better protect specific species with science. And so that's kind of, I think, some of the directions that we're heading in.
Great. So the question is, are we modifying goals, objectives based on climate change? And in general, I'd say no, we actually haven't really. In part, I think, because we sort of have been doing that for a while. But on the natural resource side, I think we just redoubled our efforts on groundwater and the importance of groundwater and surface water and getting water rights to the lands that we purchased. So we've really been working pretty hard on the water side and the water rights side. But sort of echoing what Don just said in a different way is that we realize that climate change is not going to just affect the natural systems, but it's going to affect the social and political climate in which we operate. And you know, if I think about the conservation work that the county's done in the last 20 years, it's because we've had citizens in Pima County who said, we support conservation, we love these natural places, we want a board of supervisors who reflects, you know, these values that we have as a society. When that, or if that goes away, we will lose a lot of the ground that we've gained. And I think that having connection with people, allowing people connection to this landscape up here, you know, allowing access to this land, getting people to, you know, we protect the things that we love. And if we don't know them, it's hard to love them. And so we're trying, I think we've really understood that connection between these natural systems and the people that we serve, and relaying how important those natural systems are to our health. And so it's two heads of the same coin.
So I think on the note of connection that we've just heard from several people, I want to open it up to the audience to see if folks from the audience have some questions, so that you're not all just sitting there looking at us. I'm sure you have thoughts running around in your head. Do we have a microphone for audience questions, or should I use mine? No? Okay, here.
Thanks. My question was for Antonio. I was wondering if you could elaborate more on what your ideas for payment for ecosystem services and how you're getting dollars to make payments for people that are doing carbon sequestration and the ranching, and how you're identifying the sequestration that's being done.
Ahorita lo que estamos buscando, estamos en trámite en el estado de Querétaro. Hay una gestión que se hizo con el gobierno estatal para tener una participación de los impuestos vehiculares. Y en ese sentido se crea un fondo y hay un cuerpo técnico que identifica aquellas áreas que son elegibles para recibir esos pagos, ¿no? Entonces, ese modelo está funcionando, al parecer, bien en Querétaro. Y lo que estamos buscando es replicar ese modelo en los estados de Chihuahua y de Sonora, ¿no? Se han estado buscando acercamientos. De hecho, hace dos días José Manuel estuvo con la gente del gobierno del estado, tiene una cita con la gobernadora para explicarle este modelo y tratar de implementar esto acá. También se está buscando una cita con el gobernador electo en Chihuahua. Entonces, básicamente es buscar que de impuestos se cree un fondo para esto.
So yeah, we have a better practice in Querétaro where the state government took a part of the vehicle tax and put it in a fund. And there's a technical committee that chooses which areas are the best to get that money to. And we are trying to replicate that in the states of Chihuahua and Sonora. Just 2 days ago, Jose Manuel was with the governor of Sonora talking about this possibility. And we have a meeting with the governor of Chihuahua to try to replicate that. So it's basically through taxes that we would get that funding.
Okay. La segunda opción, que es más complicada, es este concepto que se llama la LAMA. Que son los, pues, son bonos, son bonos de carbono, pero ahorita es muy difícil porque la mayoría de los bonos de carbono se están aplicando para incentivar tecnologías verdes, la parte gris de esto, y la parte de los bonos verdes o la parte verde de captura de carbono no tiene suficiente apoyo, entonces todavía está en gestión. Realmente ahorita estamos en preparación. Hay algunos ranchos pilotos que están midiendo como la línea base para carbono y en 3 años tendremos una medición para ver qué tanto hemos capturado y a ver si para entonces, pero es, estamos en gestiones, si para entonces ya están disponibles esos fondos para esto.
Well, our second choice is a little tougher than the first one, which would be carbon bonds, because right now most of the carbon bonds are given to green technology and not carbon capture. So there's a gray area there. And what we're doing now is that we're working with some ranchers to evaluate the carbon baseline. And we hope that in 3 years we can have a measurable outcome and see where that goes. But it's at a later state.
Okay, thank you. Is there another question in the audience? Oh, you've got one. Great.
Thank you, panel, for all your insights here. Through the Spring Stewardship Institute, we get to work with many different organizations in different parts of the world. And one of the strategies that has come up in some big landscapes, such as Southern Nevada and the three-state area of Southern California and Arizona and Southern Nevada, has been interagency, regular interagency meetings. And I wonder how often you all meet together, and is that an option for the Sky Islands area? In other words, perhaps quarterly meetings to talk about commonalities, challenges, et cetera, that might be, because so many of your resources cross political boundaries. That might also be something the Sky Island Alliance could facilitate and then really bring these voices together in a way that has much more regular communication.
I'm going to punt this to Louise in terms of the, I mean, wouldn't this be an appropriate sort of role for DLCC and SAA to play?
Yeah, I think there are certain, this is part of what we're hoping to come out of this meeting with is some, you know, some thinking from this group around how we need to be coordinating, and we'll talk more about that this afternoon, and, you know, what in addition to things that are already being done, like the Sky Island Restoration Cooperative, the Cienega Watershed Partner, you know, these other efforts, SWARO coordinating with many different agencies and entities around them. So I think it's a great point, and I think we're going to address that more throughout the day as we think about next steps and coordinating. I don't know if other folks on the panel want to respond to that.
I'll just mention, just quickly that, a lot of decisions that affect some of the issues that we're talking about over these 2 days are really kind of, they go far beyond the federal agencies that are here. And I think, you know, we really need to think about just community engagement in general and working with the entire spectrum of groups that influence and make decisions in society and sort of getting that out there. So I just put in a word for that.
So there was a Tucson Basin Managers meeting, but it was really driven by one individual who left the region, Sherry Barrett, and it hasn't been picked up again, something we were actually looking to do maybe. So, but it is needed, yep.
Hi, I just had a couple of comments just to support your discussion of getting people involved. There are groups here, Sky Island, Borderlands Restoration, who are doing amazing jobs with engaging students, Leadership Institute, getting high school students out, building this thing called Restoration Economy. So I just wanted to call that out because I don't think it can be said enough. They are our future and it's changing minds in super visible ways. And then a couple of things for Antonio. So there is something called, it's a farm ranch carbon management tool that's been developed by the Agronomic Society of America. I can send you a link on that, where you can actually talk about management practices for farms and ranches and how you can improve carbon sequestration, et cetera. And then I had a question for you, Antonio, about Conagua. So maybe not a lot of people know, in Mexico, water is one resource. In the United States, it's managed completely differently, state by state. And so Conagua is in charge of not just groundwater or surface water, but ocean, atmosphere, climate research, and they're huge. And so I'm just wondering, have they been engaged in this process? We work with them on our transboundary aquifer studies quite closely. And so just because it's difficult to do much without their permission, has there been much engagement?
No, realmente no, directamente no está involucrado. Lo que, bueno, está involucrado de otra manera. normal, uno de los grandes problemas que tenemos en México y en particular en esta zona de Chihuahua, pero aplica para todo México, en el cambio de uso de suelo, en un acuífero que ya no tiene permiso para ser explotado. Para nosotros es, bueno, antes nos sorprendía, pero es cosa de todos los días que se siguen abriendo más pozos y más pozos y más pozos. Entonces, sabemos que hay vacíos en la ley que de alguna manera permite que un nuevo pozo ilegal se mantenga funcionando o se haga legal. No sabe, y hemos preguntado con gente de Semarnat, de Profepa, que bueno, Semarnat es la agencia ambiental y Profepa es como la policía ambiental, vamos a decir. Y no sabemos cómo, no sabemos, suponemos, tenemos muchas ideas de las razones de por qué funcionan así y no son buenas razones. Pero es la forma en que vemos que Conagua está involucrada, autorizando cosas que no debería de autorizar.
So we see illegal wells sprunging out all over Mexico, and we have talked to Semarnat, which is the equivalent of EPA, and we have talked to Profepa, which is like the environmental police, and we don't know why. We have our theories, we have sort of clues about why this is happening, but they're not good reasons. They're never good reasons, and it has to do with Conagua authorizing something that they shouldn't, and that's what affecting us the most.
Just one comment. I lo voy a decir en español, es más fácil. La Conagua se maneja por cuencas, entonces algo que digo, yo no digo que las cosas vayan perfectamente bien, pero un avance ha sido que hoy por hoy hay una ONG, que en este caso somos Pronatura. Estamos sentados en el Consejo de Cuenca de la Conagua, del Río Bravo. Entonces, este Consejo de Cuenca, para que ustedes tengan una idea, se sienta el gobernador de cada uno de los estados que forma la cuenca del Río Bravo. Se sienta también la persona de Zagarpa, de Semarnat, todas las cabezas grandes de diferentes instancias gubernamentales. Y pues somos minoría, honestamente. Solamente son dos representantes de universidad y una ONG. pero esto es un avance, ¿no? Entonces tenemos voz, pues obviamente somos minoría, ¿verdad? Pero yo creo que ya es un avance el poder estar ahí. Eso es algo que no había sucedido. Creo que nunca había habido una ONG sentada en el Consejo de Cuenca de la Conagua, ¿no? Este consejo, como pues, su nombre lo dice, toman decisiones sobre cómo utilizar los recursos y cómo manejar el recurso hídrico, ¿no?
So I just want to make a few points about Conagua, because in the case of sheds, they are divided by they're divided by basins. So there's a committee where people from ProNatura and everybody else, very big bosses, are all sitting together, and it has been an advance for us as an. There's two universities and one nonprofit that are now sitting in that council, and that had never happened before. So we are a minority. It's not like they're listening to us, but it is important that we're there. And it's never council. This has never happened. So it's a big step towards what we want.
All right. Thank you. I think in the interest of staying on schedule, I'd like to ask the panel to give a few concluding remarks, speaking to sort of important next steps, thoughts you want to share as we move into the day with this conservation design work and thinking forward into this longer term, large landscape collaborative conservation work we've embarked on, sort of how we can address what we've been talking about through this work and what your thoughts are on that.
La verdad, cuando veníamos acá, nuestra expectativa pues, era muy baja. Realmente no entendíamos hacia dónde va este proceso, y como especialista en planificación, mi experiencia me ha dicho que muchos procesos que son ambiciosos terminan en un cajón de un escritorio, sin usar, ¿no? Entonces, mi expectativa, y puede ser hasta una solicitud para este grupo, esta es no tratar de empujar nuestros intereses particulares en cada estrategia, sino tener estrategias muy, muy selectas que sean, finalmente estamos hablando de un área piloto. Entonces, diseñemos estrategias que sean, como decimos en México, piloteables, o sea, que podamos implementar en ambos lados de la frontera. Estrategias que sabemos que van a funcionar, que la implementación va a funcionar de un modo en Estados Unidos, porque la realidad es una, y va a funcionar de otro modo en México, porque la realidad es otra.
So I have to be honest about my expectations. They were really low coming here. I didn't know what was going to happen in the process. As a planning specialist, I know that whenever I do very ambitious projects, they end up in a drawer, and I'm really disappointed. So my request, my expectation now is not to push particular interests in this process, and to be selective with the pilot area, knowing quite well that when we design, let's make it a doable pilot program that can do that can be done in both sides, even though the implementation is going to be quite different because there are major differences in the US and Mexico.
La siguiente reflexión es que este proceso, para que no se quede en un cajón, tiene que venir con recursos para poder implementar. Y la realidad de los recursos en Estados Unidos es una, y la realidad de los recursos en México es otra. Entonces, para que este ejercicio piloto funcione, debe haber estrategias que se implementen en ambos lados de la frontera. Entonces, necesitamos trabajar en conjunto para identificar las fuentes de recursos, identificar los niveles de colaboración que necesitamos tener y quién va a hacer las cosas en ambos lados, o si va a ser algo transversal, que todo un equipo va a trabajar en conjunto, ¿no? Pero sí tenemos que hacerlo, creo yo, de una manera muy, muy, muy práctica, elegir de manera muy puntual lo que vamos a hacer y poder mostrar que este piloto puede ser replicable en otras áreas de estos desiertos que son enormes, ¿no? ¿Okay?
My second thought is about it's not to let this process be in the drawer, and the answer is money, money for implementation. And the sources and ways of funding are very different in the US and Mexico, and we have to be very aware of that. So when we are choosing a pilot program, we have to have a binational strategy from the get-go. We have to identify the sources of funding, how are we going to collaborate, who does what, and work on a horizontal scale, and be very practical, be very clear that what we aim to do is make this a replicable idea that can be put in the wide range of desert that we have, because we have a large desert in both of our countries.
I'm really looking forward to spatially explicit areas to work, particularly in Mexico, and using this process as a way to bring critical involvement, existing partners and new partners in Mexico to make this a viable conservation design, and getting down into the nitty-gritty of restoration again. I think one of the most useful outcomes from my perspective and my little box that I work from is we're really lucky here in southeastern Arizona in terms of availability of restoration quality plant materials. We have Borderlands Restoration and several other local suppliers of high quality native plants to use in these projects. And unfortunately, that is not replicated in Mexico. And I think one of the most helpful projects that we could move forward is to promote local communities in Mexico producing their own native plant materials to be used in projects, so that we can really replicate the work that's being happening throughout the region, particularly for pollinators and wildlife habitat.
Moving forward, BLM is going to be moving in a direction of planning at more of a landscape scale, which is going to require us to both consider the larger landscape context and to be moving between scales. So I think an area where the larger desert landscape, where the desert LCC can help, and this pilot in particular, is figuring out how to move between those scales. And then BLM's also going to be moving towards more of a model where measurable objectives are really going to guide BLM management and the strategy on BLM land. So I think that's, and at that larger landscape level. So I think that's another area where this pilot and the Greater Desert LCC network can really help, is how to make that happen. And then some issues that we have with data set boundaries, that's sort of building those bridges across different data set boundaries, as well as keeping up to date with the latest monitoring data. I mean, from some of the presentations this morning, there's a lot of people in this region collecting monitoring data, and getting it into these geospatial databases is really a challenge. So I think that's another area that we could use quite a bit of help with.
One thing I think we need is more science. I think when we do science on the land, we learn things that have a great deal of value for management. And you know, I'm old enough, so if I'd been in this room 25, 30 years ago, this room would have been filled with graduate students. And so we have really seen a steady erosion in the kind of funding that's available for field research in this region, and I think that's unfortunate. I think we really need more of that. I think we need this room to be younger, and I think we can never lose when we get young people out on the land really studying it and really looking at it. And so I think there's great value in that. And in addition to the restoration efforts that a couple of people have referred to today, there's some amazing efforts that are going on there, and we need to do more of that. And then the second thing is just something that I mentioned earlier is, you know, landscape connectivity and landscape integrity really has a lot to do with kind of this permeability idea for water, for wildlife. And, you know, as a society, we need to think differently. We need to think outside the box. We need to, you know, work together to create kind of the vision that we've talked about today throughout all of society. And so to achieve some of the goals that I think we've talked about really requires a different vision, not just in this room, but beyond this room.
Just for Pima County, just kind of nuts and bolts, is I have to put a shout out to our new plan that we have, the multi-species conservation plan that we just approved, which is sort of a little sister of the Sonora Desert Conservation Plan. We'll be providing additional resources for monitoring and for data. And so we're really excited about that. And I'm going to completely go off script here, because I'm the last person, and I guess maybe I get the last word, which is that, so I'm originally from Canada, from British Columbia, Vancouver, and I love my home and native land. But being in the Southwest is really, what an extraordinary gift to be here. The resources that we have are so abundant. The people are so amazing. I was really building up to something. Now I'm just like, forget it. So, and I think we, I don't know exactly what I'm going to say, but I feel like we can't lose sight of the amazing place that we live, the amazing opportunity that each of us in this room, a lot of us, almost all of us, are being paid to work in this amazing field. What a gift that is. And I think that we need to remember that we're not just conservationists, but we're also members of our communities. We have families, we have friends. And in the world of all the stressors and all the threats, they kind of weigh down on us. And I know that I went to my dentist the other day. He said I have grinding marks. And I'm sure that some of that had to do with a 14-year-old daughter. I'm also sure that some of it had to do with climate change and threats and stressors and reduced budgets and all that. But I think it's incumbent upon us, both as kind of professionals and as individuals, as community members, to try to buoy ourselves as much as possible, to recognize the importance of this place, what's at stake. And at the end of the day, you know, we sort of try to have as much of a smile on our face as we can and live in the world as lightly as we can and with buoyancy. So,
all right.
That's what I had to say.
Thank you.
Okay, that was a great morning. Are you done, Louise? Okay. Thank you to the panel. And Ashwin wants to announce a talk tomorrow.
Talking on the youth, citizen science, and people's involvement in monitoring in general and collecting data. Tomorrow there's a great defense master's thesis by Emily Reynolds. She is Dr. Randy Gimlet and Dr. Melanie Culver student. And she's defending, I'll write down further details, but she's going to talk about citizen science and remote camera monitoring of jaguars and ocelots in the border region. So I would encourage you all, whoever is staying here, to go and attend that defense. And because she's going to show data of, you know, how citizen scientists are as effective or equally effective as, you know, regular scientists. So it'd be a good, interesting talk. So thank you.
Thanks. Okay. I also want to thank the amazing interpreters. This is an essential to making this whole binational approach work, so we really appreciate it. We are 15 minutes early for breaking for lunch because we want to take a group photo. And Genevieve also wants to say something. You what? Okay. Well, Kanksha wants to say something.
That's not fair. Hi. To those who haven't, I haven't been able to introduce myself to, my name is Akanksha, and I have put up a poster about my research near the trash can because I knew everyone would go there. But so strategic placement and stuff. So if you're interested in aquatic and riparian connectivity, or if you work in aquatic or riparian ecosystems in this region, you know, it would be really great to get in touch with you. And you can just drop your cards in the yellow reused envelope that is there on top. You know, I would really appreciate getting in touch with you. Thank you.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to have a group photo. We're thinking that up here is probably the quickest, big mass of people. And maybe one of the two interpreters could take it. You will. Okay, awesome. Then we're going to have our 1 hour lunch. We're going to come back to this room. Carolyn's going to actually do her scenario planning short presentation right after lunch here. And then we're going to go into our breakout groups for the rest of the afternoon, which is the most important of the whole workshop. So definitely stay through the afternoon. It's all about developing the strategies and getting more concrete. And then the wrap up with the next steps and how people want to be involved. So if we can all move to the front.